The first thing is that when you are a first, you need to forget that you're the first.
Condoleezza Rice, as you've never seen her before.
Can you cook?
I love to cook. I'm a good cook.
We sit down with the former Secretary of State to talk foreign policy.
I think diplomacy still has a chance.
And her faith.
That's where the Holy Spirit leads us.
Well, welcome to this edition of the 700 Club, the day before Thanksgiving. We hope everybody's got your turkeys and cranberry and all that stuff ready to go. But we've got a terrific program for you today. And before we get into some of the features, once again, the Republican presidential candidates got together for one of their debates. This time, they had a different subject on the table.
You're right, Pat. You know what it was? It was all about foreign policy and America's national security, including what to do with Iran. Well, our very own CBN's David Brody has a story from Washington.
While the U.S. economy is definitely volatile, so is the world around us. Newt Gingrich, now a serious frontrunner thanks to strong debate performances, weighed in on what he would do with a nuclear Iran.
Mr. Speaker, would you, if you were president of the United States, bomb Iran's nuclear facilities to prevent it from becoming a nuclear power?
Only as a last recourse and only as a step towards replacing the regime.
Herman Cain, another frontrunner, now dropping in the polls after some recent foreign policy slip-ups, was asked about whether a President Cain would help Israel attack Iran.
Dependent upon how strong the plan is, we would join with Israel for that if it was clear what the mission was and it was clear what the definition of victory was.
Ron Paul begged to differ.
No, I wouldn't do that. But there'd be good reasons, because I don't expect it to happen.
Once Israel was brought up, Mitt Romney used the opportunity to make a promise.
If I'm president of the United States, my first trip, my first foreign trip, will be to Israel to show the world we care about that country and that region.
Throughout the night, differences became evident. On Pakistan, Rick Perry and Michelle Bachmann disagreed about whether that country should receive U.S. financial assistance, even though they haven't been a reliable partner.
They've showed us time after time that they can't be trusted. And until Pakistan clearly shows that they have America's best interest in mind, I would not send them one penny. Period.
With all due respect to the governor, I think that's highly naive, because, again, we have to recognize what's happening on the ground. These are nuclear weapons all across this nation, and potentially Al-Qaeda could get a hold of these weapons.
John Huntsman and Mitt Romney did not see eye to eye over the U.S. pullout of Afghanistan.
We haven't done a very good job defining and articulating what the end point is in Afghanistan. And I think the American people are getting very tired about where we find ourselves today.
If we pull out on a precipitous basis, as Governor Huntsman suggests, that we could well see that nation and Pakistan get pulled into terror and become another launching point to go after America.
As for terrorism, the issue of TSA screening came up, and Rick Santorum was asked directly who should be profiled.
Well, the folks who are most likely to be committing these crimes, if you look at it, I mean, obviously it was people, obviously Muslims would be someone you'd look at, absolutely.
Part of the national security debate dealt with illegal immigration, where a major gap formed between Gingrich and Romney, the two current frontrunners. Should law-abiding people who came here illegally decades ago be allowed to stay in the country?
If you've been here 25 years and you got three kids and two grandkids, you've been paying taxes and obeying the law, you belong to a local church, I don't think we're going to separate you from your family, uproot you forcefully, and kick you out.
That we're going to say to the people who've come here illegally that now you're all going to get to stay, or some large number are going to get to stay and become permanent residents of the United States. That will only encourage more people to do the same thing.
With Thanksgiving just around the corner, you can be sure that these presidential candidates are just thankful to be off the debate stage. That's because there's been 11 debates now, with more coming in December. But what we've learned is that these debates do matter, and the polls seem to fluctuate with them. David Brody, CBN News, Washington.
Thanks, David. You know, I tend to agree with Newt Gingrich on this. You've got somebody that's been here for 20, 25 years. They're good law-abiding citizens, and you're going to take a bayonet and kick them across the border into another land, or put them forcibly on an airplane, fly them out of here and disrupt their family. I mean, come on, we're not going to do that. It's ridiculous. So then we talk about, well, that's amnesty, blah, blah, blah. But the truth is, we've got about 12 million people living here illegally, and many have been here for many years. There's something else that we're doing. You know, Albert Einstein was an immigrant to America. And Andy Grove of Intel is an immigrant. Some of the great minds we've had here in this nation are immigrants, and we're a nation of immigrants, and we just can't say, well, we're going to put up barriers now. There was an article I read a couple of days ago indicating we're losing hundreds of millions of dollars, or actually billions of dollars, because of our restrictive policy about tourism. You can't come, you can't get a visa into America. We want people to come here and spend their money and enjoy the sceneries and go to Yosemite and Yellowstone and travel the Blue Ridge or whatever. But oh no, it's impossible to get a visa. You have to travel to some office of some bureaucrat and wait in line and hope you can get a visa. I mean, it's ridiculous. And I know we've had a few terrorists that have come, but the majority of people who want to come here want to come and enjoy this country. And the ones that are so helpful, you look at these tremendous minds from India and China and other places like that. We need them. We need an influx of immigrants. It enriches our nation. And the Republicans have got to be careful where they go with this anti-immigration stuff. And they say, oh boy, we're pure. Well, when did your folks get here? And you know, even if you're on the Mayflower, you're still an immigrant. That's my soapbox.
That was a good soapbox to be on, because I actually agree with you, Pat.
You do?
I do, I know.
Oh, my goodness, what can I say? All right, well, you can always get the latest on the presidential race by going to David Brody's blog, The Brody File, on CBNNews.com. Well, Wendy Griffith is here pre-Thanksgiving. She's got the rest of our stories. Wendy?
Indeed. Thank you so much, Pat. And good to see unity between you and Christie this morning, this day before Thanksgiving. Well, in the news, an atheist group is challenging a cross at a California Marine base. The 13-foot cross sits on a hilltop at Camp Pendleton. It was placed there on Veterans Day in honor of veterans and those killed in Iraq and Afghanistan. The Military Association of Atheists and Free Thinkers quickly moved against it, saying the Christian symbol violates the Constitution. But the American Center for Law and Justice is fighting for the cross to remain. The ACLJ says the Constitution does not forbid using the cross to honor fallen troops. Marine officials are reviewing the issue. Pat, what do you think about that?
Wendy, the cross. Are they going to knock down all the crosses in Arlington? Are they going to knock down all the crosses in Normandy that was set up to honor fallen heroes? That's been the symbol of bravery and heroism and sacrifice. Because it speaks of the cross of Jesus, but still it's a symbol of sacrifice and death and, yes, resurrection. And I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, the Constitution doesn't say anything about this. It says Congress shall pass no law respecting an establishment of religion. A cross at Camp Pendleton, where I was serving for a short period of time in the Marine Corps, that's going to establish religion in America. That's nonsense. And of course, these things are nonsensical, but these atheists hate God. They hate religion. And they're going to use every legal technique they can to destroy our religious roots. And we need to stand up against it. It's a pity we have to, but it's like a virus that comes into your system. They're just tiny little things, but they can give you a lot of trouble. So we fight them with antibiotics. Wendy.
Pat, the movement that started out as an outcry against corporate excess and greed is now costing taxpayers nationwide millions of dollars. The Associated Press surveyed 18 cities with active Occupy Wall Street movements. It found that taxpayers are paying at least $13 million for police overtime and other city services. That's about the same amount it costs police to handle major public events and emergencies. Well, today is the busiest travel day of the year, and AAA expects even more people on the roads this Thanksgiving. 42.5 million people will travel over the holiday. That's a 4% increase from last year and the highest number of travelers since the start of the recession. And as Mark Martin reports, many of those travelers could be running into some tough weather this year.
More people traveling this Thanksgiving weekend could mean more delays, and the crowds aren't the only reason.
Many will run into monster storms. Rough weather on the east and west coast is expected to have a ripple effect on travel across the nation.
We're already seeing delays. We're seeing cancellations coming into the New York airport. Even though LA is fine right now, what might happen is the planes aren't going to make it there, and so that every airport around the country is going to be affected.
Despite gas being up 50 cents a gallon more than last year, 90% of Americans are traveling by car, many of them right into the bad weather.
Everyone is trying to get to their destinations. They want to spend time with their family and friends who they may not have seen all year long. So definitely practice patience and just look out for your fellow traveler.
Keep a watchful eye on the roads and in airports. The TSA advises if you see something unusual, say something. As far as airport security, it could run more quickly this year thanks to some new rules. The TSA says the new system is more forgiving to kids 12 and under, now considering them low security risks.
It helps reduce, yet not eliminate, pat-downs of passengers 12 and under.
Also, they've created security shortcuts for frequent flyers and airplane crews, using information already in the system to identify them.
In addition, they've installed new software and body scan machines, replacing the kind that showed graphic body images with one that displays more of a cookie-cutter outline. Mark Martin, CBN News.
Thanks, Mark. Well, not only are fuel costs up this year, so is the cost of food. The price of a basic Thanksgiving dinner is up 13% to $49.20. The average price of a turkey is up more than 20% to $1.35 a pound. That's according to a national survey by the American Farm Bureau Federation. Analysts say food prices are going up because of higher energy costs, weather, and a growing demand for food around the world. Pat, $49.20, I thought it would be more than that.
That's how much you spent?
Well, no, I mean, I thought, you know, a whole, I'm thinking, well, if you're feeding like 10 people at Thanksgiving dinner, it's going to cost you more than $50, I would think.
I would certainly think so. And Christy's here, she's feeding two.
Well, a little bit more than two. I have some people coming to the house, but two, I went grocery shopping. $200 I spent. $200, and I start thinking, the people who are coming over here, are they worth $200?
Would you buy?
I bought, you know, turkey and a butterball chicken and macaroni and cheese and all the good stuff.
Macaroni and cheese is for free, practically.
Not if you have four different kind of cheeses, the good kind of macaroni. Come on, brother. You need to have my kind of macaroni and cheese. Nevertheless, it was expensive.
I asked Dee Dee, how much are you spending? She said about $60,
$70. $60, $70? Where is Dee Dee shopping?
My wife is so frugal.
Well, how many people are coming to your house? Are you guys going to have a piece of turkey and take a bite, pass it on? What are you guys going to do? For $60-something dollars, here's a wing. Pass it.
Ten
people and $66.
That's what you did. $60, $70. I don't know.
I'm going to call Dee Dee. Not that I'm questioning her.
If I'm saying something is wrong, I will have to come over and apologize. I think that's what she told me. But I used to say, and I want to say again,
yes,
I write a check for the amount of money that we spend on our holiday food. Mm-hmm, so that means you're going to give a check to Operation Blessing for $200.
Mm-hmm. Will you put me on the spot on TV? Yes, I will.
Hoist it on your own petard. Wendy, what do you have?
That's a good challenge, Pat. Well, while you're enjoying that turkey dinner, watch out for too much salt. Salt hidden in your Thanksgiving meal may drive up your blood pressure. Sodium can easily sneak into foods that are traditionally seen on the Thanksgiving table, from salty stuffing to sodium-filled green bean casserole. Even turkey can have a large dose of salt. Even though it's naturally low in sodium, oftentimes the birds are injected with salt water to plump them up before hitting the store shelves. New government dietary guidelines say people shouldn't eat more than the equivalent of a teaspoon of salt a day. I think most of us are going to break that on Thanksgiving. Well, even though too much salt isn't good for you, giving thanks is very good for you. Psychologists say that gratitude can make you happier and change your attitude about life. They say it's important to focus on the people you're grateful for and what things would be like if those people weren't in your life. And they say gratitude also acts as a buffer against stress and can really change your attitude and your outlook on life. And Pat, I'm so thankful for so many things this year. I have a boyfriend this Thanksgiving.
I'm thankful for that. Oh, you got a boyfriend?
Yes, first time. Yeah.
It's an answer to our prayer.
And many other things, but mainly that.
Well, Wendy, we're grateful for you. I'll give thanks for you and Christy.
That was so cute.
Yeah.
Okay, so Pat, what are you thankful for? Especially, you know, with you and I hosting, what are you thankful for?
Am I supposed to say I'm so thankful for you? I mean, giving me trouble week after week. What can I say?
Pretty much. And I'm thankful for you too, Pat.
Keep me humble. That's a good thing. All right. Seriously, ladies and gentlemen, when you have your Thanksgiving meal, you're full up with food, you got all this delicious stuff, you know, pies and turkey and all that. During the meal, go around the table and ask everybody what they're thankful for. I mean, really give thanks to God and give Him praise. The stuff He's done, you know, it's so easy to focus on the negatives. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't like this, and I don't like that, and I don't like the other, and isn't that, and I'm getting ripped off here. Just praise God that you're living in the midst of a land of a bounty and a land of freedom and a land of blessing like we have here. Thank You know, I mean, Warren Buffett talked about winning the ovarian lottery. I think it is so great. I mean, you know, we could have been born in the slums of Delhi or the slums of one of those Asian cities and desperately poor. Think of the blessing of God. So this Thanksgiving, let's give Him thanks and praise. And now we're going to give thanks and praise to my dear co-hostess who had a fabulous interview with a very intelligent lady.
Very much so. Made was literally the highlight of my year. Coming up, Condoleezza Rice on weapons of mass destruction.
After the invasion of Iraq, Muammar Gaddafi decided that weapons of mass destruction were really not worth it. We disarmed him. It may interest people to know that we actually carted back most of his most dangerous weapons to Tennessee.
Interesting facts. Well, Dr. Rice reveals more about foreign policy, world economics, her family, and her personal faith. After this.
Still ahead, our chat room is open and we want to hear from you. We'll bring it online with your questions, so don't go away.
If you have diabetes and you're on Medicare, call now for a new pain-free meter. These new meters are more accurate, they're easier to use, and the best news is you don't have to prick your fingers anymore. Call now, and Arriva Medical will send you one of these new meters for free. And if you have Medicare, your testing supplies may also be covered. Arriva makes it simple. They bill Medicare directly. There are no upfront costs. And they deliver your supplies right to your door for free. With these new meters, there's no coding, you don't have to prick your fingers, and some of these meters even talk.
Your blood glucose reading is 122.
Call 1-800-284-4105. We will send you a free Betty Crocker Diabetes Cookbook filled with delicious recipes.
Call Arriva today. You'd be glad you did.
Tomorrow, celebrate Thanksgiving with the 700 Club.
It's sort of the opening act for Thanksgiving Day for a lot of American families.
We'll give you a healthy serving of food.
Oh, yummy, yummy, yummy.
Football.
I was imagining Ennis Smith doing exactly what they were doing.
And fun.
I've heard of it.
Oh, okay.
We have some stories about it.
On a special edition of the 700 Club.
Well, welcome back to the 700 Club. Condoleezza Rice was the 66th United States Secretary of State and the first black woman to hold that office. Well, prior to that, she was the first woman to serve as National Security Advisor. Well, last week, I had the privilege of sitting down with Dr. Rice in Washington, D.C. to talk about the 8 years she served as the highest levels of government. It was a great interview. See for yourself. Take a look. So the first time we met was about a year ago when you were talking about your book, Extraordinary Ordinary People.
Right.
And you really talked a lot about your parents and the influence that they had in your life. Your new book, No Higher Honor, the first couple pages you talk about your dad and how you actually came to a crossroads.
In really one of the great ironies, my father became very ill just before I was to go to Washington when now President-elect Bush said that he wanted me to become National Security Advisor. And I thought, I can't do this. I can't leave my father. And the wonderful thing is I had that conversation with the president-elect, and he said, I'm not asking you to leave your dad, but I need you in Washington. And so we worked out some crazy idea that I would come back every 2 weeks to California, probably unworkable. My father died on December 24th, and that was just a few days before I would leave for Washington. He knew that I was going to become national security advisor. But I'll never forget that last conversation with him. I called him from a friend's house, and I said, how are you? And he said, well, I'm going home. And I said, Daddy, you are at home. And he said, no, I'm going home. And it suddenly dawned on me, of course, this man of God, this faithful man for all of his years, was saying to me that the Lord had called him home. And indeed, the Lord had called him home.
Your dad was a registered Republican.
In those days, they had what's called a poll test in order for people to register to vote. My father, a big, dark-skinned man, he said, how many beans are in this jar? And here was this huge jar of beans. Of course, no one could count. And my father was really devastated. But this elder in his church, Mr. Frank Hunter, said, oh, Reverend, I'll tell you how to get registered to vote. He said, you go down there, and there's a clerk. She's a Republican. She's trying to build the party. And so my father found this woman. She registered him to vote. And he never forgot it. He was a lifelong Republican after that.
Is that why you're a Republican?
Well, I went through a long journey toward being a Republican. I actually registered as a Democrat when I first could vote in 1976, the first presidential campaign for me. Jimmy Carter was the reconciliation of North and South. But then I was very disturbed by the Soviet onslaught when the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan. And our only decision or our only action was to boycott the Olympics. I thought we need somebody who understands power. And I voted for Ronald Reagan. A couple of years later, I became a Republican. I really never looked back. So it was foreign policy initially that brought me to the party. Strength and peace through strength, as President Reagan used to say.
Well, let's talk about what's going on in the world today, especially the Middle East. Now, with Muammar Gaddafi, in your book, you say that we had to remove weapons from him, or weapons were taken away from him.
Yes.
And there was not a doubt in your mind that he would have used them.
Absolutely, yeah. Because we were fortunate that after the invasion of Iraq, Muammar Gaddafi decided that weapons of mass destruction were really not worth it. And he gave up his weapons of mass destruction. We disarmed him. It may interest people to know that we actually carted back most of his most dangerous weapons to Tennessee, Oak Ridge, Tennessee, where they were dismantled. And so he didn't have those weapons of mass destruction when the revolution took place in Libya. And I'm glad that he didn't, because I have no doubt that he would have probably used them sitting in that bunker for the last time.
Well, let's talk about Iran. You know, is there a fear? Is there something in you that says, you know what? If he builds up these nuclear weapons, he's definitely going to use them. Do you think that?
Well, I worry about Iran. It's probably the most dangerous single country in the world. It's also a regime that is the poster child for state sponsorship of terrorism. They've got tentacles of terrorism all over the world, and they're seeking a nuclear weapon. A nuclear weapon in Iran would be an unimaginable danger, and we have to stop it. The president of the United States cannot take military force off the table.
I heard in one interview you said that the position of not just national security advisor, but secretary of state, kind of felt like the inbox.
Yes.
All problems came to you. All intel came to you.
Right.
When you have such knowledge of what's going on in the world today, how do you get to the point where you're not walking in fear?
Well, in fact, right after 9/11, I think we were fearful. We were fearful of the next attack. We were sure it was coming. There was an anthrax scare. I describe in the book a botulinum toxin scare, a radiological smallpox. So yes, it was pretty scary. But several things get you through. First of all, faith. I remember that Abraham Lincoln is said to have said, when he had nowhere else to go but his knees, he understood the power of faith and prayer. That certainly was an important part of it. It was good to be around other people who had the same faith. President Bush is a person of faith, and it helped to work with people like that.
There was recently an article. It said, Condoleezza Rice shares Christian faith with students, advises them to trust in the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
I love that you are candid, not just about your faith, but the role that the Holy Spirit has in your life. Let's talk about that.
I grew up in a family where faith was at the center of everything. It wasn't that you thought about your faith as something out here. It was integral to you. And I was taught early on that we'd been given a Holy Spirit to stay with us until the day that he returns. And that for me had always been the most comforting part of our religious tradition.
Did that also help you with making decisions during, you know, would you pray, Lord, tell me where to go, tell me what to say, tell me how to handle this?
I would say, Lord, guide my steps today. And that was my morning prayer, just guide my steps today.
You are known not just as a woman of poise, not just as a woman of brilliance, but also the first national security advisor female, the first black female secretary of state. But when you were the first, you're also the first one to encounter walls and mindsets and obstacles. So how did you deal with that? How do you deal with that?
Well, the first thing is that when you are a first, you need to forget that you're the first and give other people the benefit of the doubt. So it's all too easy to look around and think they're reacting to it because I'm a woman. They're reacting that way because I'm black. And generally, you just end up driving up your own blood pressure. If you let someone treat you badly because you're a woman or because you're black, it's your fault, not theirs. You have plenty of ammunition in your arsenal to back someone down who's treating you badly. So I'm not much given to victimhood. I really do think that my parents taught me that you may not be able to control your circumstances, but you can control your response to your circumstances. And if you always keep that in mind, you'll let people's prejudices be their problem, not yours.
You are teaching me. I completely forgot the next question because I'm sitting here like, I got to get that note. With CBN, you know, we're always praying for our nation, praying for our leaders. What are maybe some of the top three areas within our world that we need to focus on to pray about?
Well, we first and foremost need to pray that the harm and the hurt that people are doing to each other will somehow resolve and that the Lord will be in some of these terrible places. Secondly, for the compassion of our nation. We're a powerful country, but we are at our best when we are a compassionate people. And then finally, to pray for our leaders, that they will have wisdom, that they will have judgment, and that they will see that this is a special and great country that has special responsibilities.
I said this before, but it really is and was an honor just to sit down with Dr. Rice. She makes people better when you are in her presence. It's awesome. Well, listen, that was not the end of my interview with Condoleezza Rice. Still ahead, a lighter side of Condi that you never, ever, ever see, and you won't see anywhere else. You're going to find out her pet peeve, her guilty pleasure, and other tidbits when we come back. Plus, we're also going to be taking your questions for Pat. In fact, Cheryl says, she says, we pray for our spiritual life and our physical healing. What about our souls? Do they get wounded and should we pray for them as well? Well, we're going to bring it on with Cheryl's question and a lot more. So don't go away.
Coming up later.
She was attractive. She was pleasant to talk to.
A husband takes up with his secretary.
I told my wife that I didn't love her anymore.
And kicks his wife to the curb.
I was just in absolute misery. It felt like there was a black cloud over my head.
How their marriage was saved on today's 700 Club.
Do you have money to burn? If not, you need to know that the paper dollars you're invested your life savings in are being consumed right now in a growing blaze of inflation and declining value. Economists know why the dollar is burning and at risk of crashing. It's because politicians and central bankers keep printing them. And this makes the dollars you've worked so hard for worth less and less. The politicians and bankers hated the gold standard because it forced them to be honest. That's why the US dollar keeps losing value and could soon crash. The good news is that you can create your own personal gold standard and keep your savings protected when the dollar crashes. Call or visit online now. Find out more about the best performing assets of the 21st century. from the best company in the country, Swiss America.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Okay, now here's the fun part. Well, Condoleezza Rice is known for her brilliance, her beauty, and her unflappable poise. But I knew that there was a side to Condi that we could all relate to, and I had to draw that out of her. But it was so much fun. You got to see for yourself. Take a look. We have about 5 minutes left, and I thought I'd have some fun. Are you game?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay. What's your favorite cereal?
Cheerios.
What is your favorite 1960s or 1970s sitcom?
Mary Tyler Moore Show.
What's your biggest pet peeve, the thing that drives you batty?
That I am such a procrastinator.
Never would have thought it because you came here
right,
on time.
Right.
What is your guilty pleasure?
Anything that's a vehicle for salt. Potato chips, popcorn, pretzels.
Can you cook?
I love to cook. I'm a good cook.
Favorite meal of all time?
Fried chicken.
Hot sauce or no hot sauce?
Hot sauce.
Come on. Craziest thing you've ever done?
You think I'd tell you that?
I thought I would try. All right. What's that one thing at Thanksgiving you just have to have?
It's mac and cheese.
Sister, that is my dish. That is the one thing that I can rock.
But only once a year.
Why do you deprive yourself?
Because,
you work out 6 days a week.
Yes, but you know, you have to worry about those calories.
That works. Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure.
That was so much fun. And I have to tell you, there's one question that I did ask Pat. I said at the very end of the interview, I said, you know, you are a professor at Stanford. So if you were to grade this interview, what grade would you give it? And she goes, I would give it an A. I said, why not an A plus? And she goes, because you asked me what the craziest thing I've ever done. Yeah. Listen, Condoleezza's Rice, it is called No Higher Honor. It's available wherever books are sold. And I do have to say this, seriously. It could look very intimidating and daunting because it's almost 800 pages. But I loved it. I think any you know, child who wants to know about history and foreign policy and what's going on in the government would love it. But at the same time, just the normal person who kind of wants that behind the scenes little twist, she tells some interesting stories that we never hear.
The name of the book is?
Once again, No Higher Honor by Dr. Condoleezza Rice.
Well, good interview, Christy. Congratulations.
Thank you, Pat.
What is this mac and cheese? Is that a black thing?
It is a black thing, Pat.
It is a black.
Listen, and you guys, other people, the world needs to get on board with macaroni and cheese. Seriously, Christmas and Thanksgiving, we have to have macaroni and cheese, and it trips me out that you don't.
I really don't. I don't, and I have never.
You know what the problem is?
What's that?
I don't think you've had good macaroni and cheese because we don't do Kraft. We don't do the whole little stuff in a box.
You know.
We do the good old kind that our grandmamas made.
Well, my grandmama didn't make macaroni
and
cheese.
Your grandma?
All right, what's next?
All right.
Go ahead.
This might be the year I make you some, Pat. All right, so it's time to bring it on with your email questions. Cheryl starts us off, and she says, we pray for our spiritual life and our physical healing. What about our souls? Do they get wounded, and should we pray for them as well?
My soul doth magnify the Lord. The soul is you. It's all of you. Mm-hmm. You know, the merging together of your body and your spirit makes you. So you say, should we pray for me? Well, of course, but the spirit is the thing that you're concerned about. That's the part that gets closer to God. But that's what it says, my soul doth magnify the Lord. And David said, I afflicted my soul with fasting. So you can, you know, deal with yourself, but when you ask forgiveness, you're asking forgiveness for your soul, what you've done wrong, all right?
Absolutely. When you think about your soul as your mind, your will, and your emotions, and each of those things can get hurt very easily. That's why they're called soul wounds. So absolutely, you can pray for those, and the Lord can heal them. All right. Darla says, if you've treated anybody badly, do you have to tell them in person that you're sorry, or, ooh, I like this question, or can you just ask God for forgiveness? Okay, go.
The Bible says when you offer your gift and you remember that someone has ought against you, go to that one, make it right, and then offer your gift. So if you've got somebody wandering around who hates you, and it's got something against you, you want to get it right to them before you go before God and say, oh, here's my gift and I praise the Lord. So the answer is yes. If you have wounded somebody, you need to go to them and say, you know, I'm sorry, I did the wrong thing. And you might find how wonderful that is, what a release that is in your own spirit. All right, next question.
Brilliant word. Oh, brilliant. Love it.
All right.
Christy, but not this Christy, asked, I need work. How should I pray about finding a job?
Talk to the Lord. You know what the Bible says? Give us this day our daily bread. We need our daily bread. And that's the prayer. Give us this day our daily bread. And work, job is getting our daily bread. And so you can say, Father, you know, your son Jesus taught us to pray for our daily bread. And I'm praying now. I need work so I can be able to eat. All right.
Absolutely. You know, one good thing about the Lord is He loves to order our steps. And that's part of the Lord, tell me where to go. Tell me what to do.
Right.
Dan says, after Cain killed his brother Abel, God put a mark on him to protect him. Exactly what was this mark? And was it physical or like a tattoo or brand of some sort? Or was there like an elaborate theological interpretation to it?
I think theological, because the animals wouldn't eat him either. So I think there must have been some spiritual, I hate to use the term aura because it has the wrong connotation, but it's that sense that the presence of God was upon him so people wouldn't hurt him. So the mark of Cain, but he didn't put a brand on him, I don't think.
Interesting.
All right.
Jody says, can you really influence God with prayer? Isn't His will for me already prescribed?
Well, what you basically are doing is influencing yourself. As you pray, you're getting more and more in line with the will of God. And you're asking for something, but, you know, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So as you're saying, thy will be done, you're asking it to be done on earth in me. And so you're submitting yourself and molding yourself into the will of God. No, you're not going to change God's mind. No, that's not the way it happens. But He will bring you into conformity with the way that you'll have a blessing. He's got a blessing for you, and He wants you to line up with the way you get the blessing. All right?
You're just on a roll.
Oh, but keep going.
Rock your stuff. Okay, Diana says, recently my Bible study group discussed if we should say, if it would be thy will, kind of what you're saying, when praying. Some said that this diminishes faith in the expected answer to prayer. But Jesus said, not my will, but thy will be done. You just kind of hit on that.
Okay. Well, it diminishes. If I'm praying for somebody who's sick, the thing I need to do is ask God, God, are you going to heal that person? And the Lord says, yes, I'm going to heal that person. Then you're not going to ask God if it's His will. You declare, in the name of Jesus, be healed. So if you say, be healed if it be your will, then you've killed your faith because you are declaring something that you already know in your heart is done. But that's the thing, before you begin to pray, you're asking God, get me into conformity with what your will is, and then, bang.
There you go.
All right.
Eric asks, somebody broke into our house and stole my wife's jewelry. Now, I'm scared, and my wife wants me to buy a gun, but is that showing a lack of faith in God to protect us?
What was the pilgrim that was carrying a gun, and the guy said, brother, don't you know that when your time comes, that, you know, God will end you. And he said, why are you carrying the gun? We said, well, I may meet an Indian whose time has come before mine. So, I don't think there's anything wrong with having a weapon in your home to protect yourself. I really don't. I think these monsters that come in and terrorize people and beat up their children and rape the women and all that kind of stuff, the fact that if they know you've got a gun, Ronald Reagan talked about peace through strength. The best way to have peace is to be prepared for war. And if some crook knows that you're armed, he's going to leave you alone. If he thinks your house is a place where he's going to get shot breaking in, he's going to leave you alone. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's just one of those things. So, but guns are scary. Most people can shoot themselves. And the idea of putting somebody to death through a weapon is just not in keeping with Christianity. So it's a problem. But anyhow, being prepared is not the worst thing in the world. All right.
Okay. We have time for a couple more. Crystal says, I've been trying to bring my husband closer to the Lord and have had little success. He believes there's a God but does not want to participate in church or in prayer. What can I do without forcing him?
Crystal, continue to live your life. Live a godly life. Isn't that what the Bible says, that without a word you can lead your husband to faith by the when they see your godly living, there's something about you. And when a trial comes, and the trial will come, all of a sudden you'll stand like a rock. And your husband will say, what is it you've got? But in the meantime, you pray for him, you love him, and you live your life before him, and watch what happens.
That's it. And that
That's
was a great
all?
Way to end it, yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Very good. That was very good.
I can't believe it. That plus a recipe for mac and cheese, my cup runneth over. Well, Harry is a husband and father who worked long hours every day to put food on the table for his family. But he also had to work all night fetching water for them. Take a look.
Hari Bhai is a brick mason in Western India. He worked hard from dawn to dusk to provide for his family. But when his work day was done, he still had one more task.
We didn't have any drinking water in our village. So after work, I had to hike for miles throughout the night to get to an open well.
I felt helpless. I had to work in the fields during the day, and I couldn't get the water myself at night.
Since it was too dangerous for the women to make the long trek, Hari and other men from the village traveled together. Sometimes they had to wait several hours for the water to rise. Many times Hari stayed up all night to get water and then had to go back to work. A local pastor wanted to help.
When I found out that Hari and his village had to travel so far to get water, I contacted CBN's Living Waters team for help. They soon came out and drilled a well.
Now we have safe drinking water right in our village. You have brought so much happiness to our home.
I am so thankful that I can be with my family and sleep at home instead of getting water at night. It feels so good to wake up refreshed and ready to go to work.
A whole village is rejoicing because of you. And how do you get that way? I would just think it's just $20 a month. It's 65 cents a day. And with those things together, we can do miracles around the world. So I'm so thrilled about this. And for those who want to join the 700 Club, if you don't have this, you need it. You need to know what prophecy has to say. I was reading a book this guy has written about these signs that are coming, the harbingers of stuff. And it's just fascinating. It's simply fascinating. So on the 3rd of January, this gentleman's going to be here to talk about his harbingers. But we've got, these are not harbingers, but this is what the Bible has to say, signs of the times. This is what the Bible says, and I want you to have it. Real simple. Find out what's happening next. People say, what's going to happen next? Well, here it is. 1-800-759-0700. This is what our gift to you when you join the 700 Club.
Good deal. Well, up next, we have an amazing story, Pat. Oh, a husband who dropped a bomb on his wife.
On my 40th birthday, I told my wife that I didn't love her anymore.
It was more comfortable for me to be in denial and pretend he hadn't said it than to really let those words sink in.
But she didn't stay in denial very long. In fact, you're going to see what happens up next.
Thanksgiving is one of the best times of the year, when we remember God's blessings with the people we love. This year, you can make CBN's The Power of a Thankful Heart a meaningful part of your celebration.
Your Thanksgiving gift brings life-changing help to people in need. You feed the hungry all around the world, including those here at home. Watch for this mailing. Remember God's blessings and send in your gift. Serve up God's love this holiday season. Give so others can know God's faithfulness. It's like inviting the world to your Thanksgiving table.
Something inside of me just told me I need to get checked out. The doctor said we found something and we need to get into surgery.
Beth Gomez had stage 3 colon cancer.
That's when we scheduled an appointment for a second opinion at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans. At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
You had a whole team. I wasn't just going to fight this battle. They were going to stand beside me and fight it.
Our physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you treatment options you may not even know exist.
Cancer makes you really appreciate what's important in your life.
Please call or go to cancercenter.com today. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. A fifth day of deadly clashes in Egypt between police and anti-government protesters. An Egyptian military ruler promised to hold a presidential election in the first half of 2012, but tens of thousands of protesters in Tahrir Square responded by chanting, "Leave, leave, leave." Protesters are demanding the country's military step down from power after it took over for ousted President Hosni Mubarak. The U.S. State Department condemned the excessive use of force by police and urged restraint. 38 people have been killed in the unrest. Operation Blessing International continues to have a presence in Haiti. Volunteers recently delivered 4,000 gallons of clean water and more than a ton of food packs to villagers. The packs included military food supplies and bags of rice and soy to help malnourished children. The supplies were delivered to 45 families in one village and 30 in another. Operation Blessing has worked in these communities ever since that devastating earthquake last year. And you can find out more about Operation Blessing by logging on to OB.org. Pat and Christy will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Do you have wrinkles and sagging skin? You'd like to remove years of aging from your face in about an hour. Now you can with Lifestyle Lift. This amazing procedure takes about 1 hour right in our office. See the difference immediately. No general or IV anesthesia. Return to your activities quickly. Call today to learn how you can receive a free laser treatment. That's right, a $950 value, free for a limited time only.
It gave me back all of my confidence.
Call Lifestyle Lift now for your free laser treatment.
What makes the miracles of Jesus even more miraculous? Standing where they happened, in Israel. Come sail the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus calmed a raging storm. Experience Jerusalem, where Jesus restored a paralyzed man. Explore Capernaum, where Jesus spoke a centurion servant into health. To learn more about standing where it all happened, in Israel, visit GoIsrael.com. Come visit Israel.
Meet Clark Davis. Solution to your hired hand problem.
I don't need any hired help.
Discover how love began. Inspired by best-selling author Jeanette Oak comes the all-new opening chapter of the Love Comes Softly series.
Give life time. We never do know what's right around the corner.
Faith means believing in something greater than oneself.
Love Begins.
Tomorrow, Judy and Paul Rousseau will be celebrating their 41st Thanksgiving together. The couple is grateful for the years they've spent together, especially when they remember the day that Paul told Judy he didn't love her anymore.
I told my wife that I didn't love her anymore.
It was more comfortable for me to be in denial and pretend he hadn't said it than to really let those words sink in.
For years, Judy pretended the marriage was okay.
Paul and Judy Russo were high school sweethearts and married young. They started a family but felt something was missing. Judy thought that going to church would fill the void.
Church to me was doing good things, singing in the choir, working at the church suppers, doing nice things for old people, sitting there counting the minutes till the service was over.
Years earlier, when Judy watched a film depicting the crucifixion of Jesus, something changed.
And I said, oh God, Jesus died for me and I give you my life. You can take it and do with me whatever you want. Paul had called from work and I answered the phone and he said, what's wrong with you? And I said, it's Jesus, he died for me. And I just gave him my life.
Paul was less than thrilled. In fact, as the weeks went on, he became resentful of the new Judy.
It was a big change in Judy. Being a new Christian, she was going to a lot of meetings. I felt a bit of neglect on, you know, selfishness on my part. She was busier and less time spent being in a marriage.
I always felt for some reason that God was more pleased when I did things for the people down the street or strangers than when I did the necessary things for my family.
Paul felt like he'd been kicked to the curb.
I would take off on my motorcycle. I probably wouldn't come back for a couple of days.
But that's not all. Paul sought comfort in a relationship with his young, beautiful secretary.
She was attractive, she was pleasant to talk to, but it made me feel, you know, that she cared.
Meanwhile, Judy worked full-time and raised their four kids.
I got angry. I think it was more comfortable for me to get angry at the other woman.
Paul's affair continued for several months, and Judy pressed on with church work. Eventually, Paul moved out, and the Russos filed for divorce.
There was just a lot of relief, in a sense, because there had been just so much stress in our home.
The divorce proceedings were held up for several weeks in the lawyer's office. When Judy finally asked her lawyer what was taking so long, the response stunned her.
She said, Judy, I need to be honest with you. I need to tell you that I walk with God. And because I walk with God, I cannot take your case. I will not be party to burying something that is not dead. I believe if you will be patient, your marriage will be okay.
Judy began to wonder if her marriage could be saved.
I was just in absolute misery. It felt like there was a black cloud over my head. I really had no peace about getting a divorce. Suddenly, all that confusion, all that despair, all that not knowing what to do was reduced to a mission. I was going to pray for this marriage.
Judy's first thought was that God would instantly change Paul, but he didn't. Instead, he showed Judy the changes that she needed to make.
God pointed to me and showed me that the things that I was offering my husband and labeling love was nothing but a bunch of conditional terms. I'll do this if you'll do that, and I did so much of this, so you need to love me. But God's love is nothing like that. And during those 3.5 years, I was to come to learn that love is not so much in the receiving, but it's in the giving.
She prayed for Paul at least 2 hours a day, searched her Bible, and underlined the promises of God. Unbeknownst to her, Paul had ended his affair and was grappling with his own relationship with God. He expressed his thoughts to Judy in a letter.
I felt that something definitely really changed within me. And then I had to ask the forgiveness of my wife and my children. But I felt with God, through his power, he would get me through that.
People would say, well, how can you trust your husband now that he's done this? Somehow, even with the midst of the pain and all of this, God gave me that sense of, it's all good. It's all going to be okay.
She was different. We became friends again first, and then, our marriage was just rebuilt from that.
For the first time in their 24-year marriage, Paul and Judy attended church together. Paul's newfound faith in God made him a different person.
I started getting involved with scripture. I started going back to church and realizing how much Christ loved me and forgave me. And that was the huge thing. When God forgives you, it's a real deal.
Judy changed also as she learned God's priorities for her as a wife.
I did make some changes by being much more available. And even today, he still has to remind me to sit down and just take a time to enjoy the simple little things.
The Russos renewed their vows on their 30th anniversary. They celebrated this milestone and shared their full testimony with friends and family.
I would always tell people that, you know, it's not on my own, it's him that's making that change within me. Someone's marriage that's falling apart, there's a loneliness, you don't know where to turn. The only source is Christ.
You know, when people get married, they pledge a vow, and it says, until death do us part. And when you part a marriage, it is a type of death. There's a love that was there. There had to be. The Russos, Paul and Judy, had to have love somewhere along the way. There was a love that started that marriage. And out of that marriage comes children, usually. And the children grow up, and the husband and wife have many memories they share together. There have been trials and suffering and obstacles they've overcome together. And then all of a sudden, that's going to fall apart, and they will now be two separate people living apart and hoping to find some relationship someplace that will give them some comfort. Until death do us part. That's a death. That's why God says, I hate divorce. I hate it. Now, some of you may be contemplating that. You think, oh, it's an easy way to go divorce. No, it's not. It's not easy at all. You're throwing away a life. You're throwing away your future, not to mention what you'll do to your finances. But there'll be a grief, and there'll be a death. And right now, I want to pray for marriages, whatever it is. If you'll pray with me, Lord, I pray for these marriages. I pray that you might rekindle the love that was once there. I pray that you might bring joy in this holiday season, that you might bring them together, that they might look for the things that drew them together initially, and that they might give thanks for the time they have shared together, that they'll give thanks for their children, thanks for their loved ones, thanks for the opportunity to build a home together. Lord, take away the little confusion. Take away the hurts and let your grace fill each marriage. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We've got something we'll be glad to give you. It's called Love and Marriage. Some real good teachings that are here about marriage, love, living together. Discipline in your home, personal growth, set good priorities, establish a proper altar in your home. We'll send this to you free. If you want to, just give us a call. Well, tomorrow, we've got former football great Emmitt Smith, who talks about football, dancing. He won Dancing with the Stars in his personal fight. And today, we leave you with these words from Psalm 118, I think it is. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. We'll see you tomorrow, Thanksgiving Day.
This season, experience the true meaning of Christmas with Christmas Radio on CBN.com. Christmas, a time for being home with the ones you love. Special time to help others. A time to celebrate the best gift of all, Jesus Christ. Cherish this holiday season with the ones you love.
Experience Christmas Radio on CBN.com.